does it mean? Patriots running Hong Kong. How would you understand that?
A patriot means somebody who loves his country and also loves his city and its people. This is a terminology that was used by the late Deng Xiaoping when he formulated the one country, two system. So this is something which is not new per se, because it has been around for a long, long time. And indeed, I believe most Western countries will understand this very, very well, that patriots should be the ones who run the country and should be the ones who are in charge for the benefit and for the benefit of the country and the benefit of its people.
At the beginning of this wonderful book, we talk about the main problem of the early colonial Hong Kong, the terrible management. The fact is that there were few talented or qualified specialists among the colonists that the colonial administration could hire to ensure a high level of public service. The Chinese population that followed the British occupation consisted mainly of new immigrants.
In general, there was no normal elites, no educated officials, nothing.
Hong Kong was seen as a place of profit, and there was also an acute problem of discrimination against the Chinese, and contempt and distrust on both sides, as many officials abused power.
They tried to solve this problem using the Baiyohe system. The Chinese peace officers failed to establish themselves as an effective assistance to the colonial government.
There were also severe institutional problems in Hong Kong. Neither the colonial government nor the local Chinese viewed their relationship as one between the government and the citizens. The officials abused their power because they knew that the local Chinese had nowhere to go for help.
By the end of the second decade, Hong Kong had expanded and matured thanks to the Anglo-Chinese War.
Gained the financial autonomy, gained the right to discuss the annual budget before submitting it to the colonial office in Britain, and generally fared better. The Hong Kong cadet system was one of the first attempts to institutionalize the recruitment of senior civil servants through competitive examinations in the British Empire as a whole.
The Japanese invasion and occupation of Hong Kong brought several crucial changes, such as it destroyed the superiority of white race.
Governor Sir Andrew Caldecott said that in the future no appointment would be made in Great Britain until the qualifications of Hong Kong candidates had been first examined.
And it gave a new political outlook.
Kazakh proposed to rename the Crown Colony and administered it as the Free Port. Governors should be supported by an elected council, people should have equal opportunities without discrimination, and give the same privilege for citizens within the British Commonwealth.
The outlook of 1946 focused on two matters, external one, relations with China, avoid entanglement in the unfinished civil war and do not provoke the communist government, and internal one, to sustain a stable framework of government.
Now I'm going to talk about chapters number 5 and 6 and highlight several moments in these two parts of the book which really amaze me. So the main idea of the fifth chapter is the development of Hong Kong's administrative system, expansion of government activities, economic development, including industrialization. Regarding economic situation, what impressed me in this chapter were trade restrictions which the United States imposed on Hong Kong. For example, Hong Kong had to certify goods in order to prove that they were produced in Hong Kong, not in mainland China, as it was already a communist state. Moreover, these certificates were really important for Hong Kong, as without them, this colony would have a little chance to become an industrial center and would remain just a trading post. Additionally, after the Second World War, in the 1950s, Chinese population in Hong Kong grew really fast and produced new social and economic changes, and therefore The colonial government had to grow as well, so as to focus on local problems which had to be solved quickly. Such departments which were in charge of medicine, education, infrastructure, expanded and a high degree of professionalism was needed in these departments. Thus, Hong Kong always had to adjust to different kinds of changes, let them be social, economic or political ones. Talking about the sixth chapter, not only the government changed the scope of its responsibilities, but administrative officers and their work also had to face the issues of quickly changing life. What was really interesting in the sixth chapter is administrative officers' attitude towards corruption. According to Tsun, corruption seemed to be unacceptable for most of the officers, as they were happy to remove the elements of corruption from the government. Thus, such attitude was not usual, and in my opinion, it is worth mentioning the issue of corruption. Now my colleagues will talk about more ideas which seemed to be interesting for us in this book.
The localization policy was interrupted after the start of the Pacific War and Japanese occupation, and restarted after these events. By the localization policy, I mean the situation then a vacancy arose. It will be advertised with the government or locally in Hong Kong first. The cultural, familiar and educational environment of local graduates made the complexity between the government's expectation and their results. It is also important to mention gender inequality. Female officers were paid only 75% of their male salary until the principle for equal pay was accepted in 1917. The rapid growth of the population forced the government to take new responsibilities. McLehose supported reform of the government and chose to engage a modern firm of management consultants. However, officers worked with McKinsey. His idea lied in improving governance without changing the nature of the political establishment.
The 9th and 10th chapters provided some information why Hong Kong's government is so exceptional. Intellectual brilliance was not essential for the good governance, but why?
People often seen as loners, mavericks, or intimidating figures rather than good team players. They worked slower by always weighing all possible pros and cons. They could challenge the esprit de corps with a desire to improve it, and there was no assurance that their thoughtful decisions will produce the most suitable policy. Esprit de corps was a fundamental feature of the administrative cadets. The advantages are the following: strong sense of motivation, the capacity to act decisively, conscious policy, integrity, broad outlook, the ability to work with a wide spectrum of personalities, and resistance to the temptation of bribes.
Also, this period made the interest of the British Hong Kong superior, because administrative officials felt that they should work for a territory which was paying them. An inhibited political center, which is people and institutions who allocate and exercise power, but who for various reasons feel the need to exert considerable self-restraint in the exercise of such power.
This helped to work effective in the absence of democratic checks and balances, to abandon its inherently racist past, and to sustain political neutrality.